Good morning. All right, so this is an introduction to LexD on Debian. I'm Stefan Kader. I work for Canonical, the upstream project leader for LXE, LXD, LXDFS. So let's get started on LexD. First, so what's that LexD thing? LexD is the container runtime which specializes in system containers. That's a bit different to some of the other runtimes you might hear a lot about these days, Rocket, Docker, those kind. I'm going to get into a bit more details later as to how it differs. LexD, especially when compared to its predecessor, LXC, effectively, has been designed to be very simple. We've got a clean command line interface that we've really worked on to, so that it can work from our day-to-day thing, so that like your normal laptop, and then scale that all the way to hundreds of container hosts that you can all maintain with the exact same tooling and commands. It's designed to be extremely fast, thanks mostly to using containers rather than virtual machines. It is designed to very much acts like you're interacting with virtual machines, but it's dealing with containers as opposed to, so you don't have any of the kind of definition overhead and limitations you usually get with virtual machines. It also means it works with all architectures, regardless of whether they have any kind of support for virtualization extensions. It is secure by default. That means that we use all the kernel security features that are available these days to protect our containers in a way that you can give root access into a default LXD container and not be overly concerned that they're going to get root access to your host. That's pretty different from what LXD was doing, pretty different from what a number of the other container runtimes do, where even though you are fully namespaced, your user, like if your UID 0 or UID whatever in the container, it still does the kernel UID, which means that you can. If you get hold of any kind of resources that comes from outside the container, you can then escalate and escape the container. With LXD, we decided to go with all of the security features you could possibly use by default and then allow you to selectively turn off the ones that you don't need or don't want for the particular container you're running. That means that we do use user namespaces by default. Everything is running as a privileged user. If you escape a LXD container, you're going to have about as much right as a random nobody UID. Even if the user you escaped from is operating as UID 0 inside the container. LXD is also designed to be very scalable. As I said, it's the same tooling does work across the network. You can maintain multiple machines through using the exact same command line tools as you use to interact with your local LXD. It also does offer a REST API. All of the interactions that our tools do with the daemon itself are actually all over the REST API. So there's no special things you can only do locally and things that you can only do remotely. Everything can be done remotely, which means that you can then build tooling either on scripts or integration and things like OpenStack or other tools that directly interact with LXD containers that can create them, execute commands inside them, and really do whatever you want with them. So, like, if you get like a not typical, but maybe like somewhat mid-scale type deployment of LXD, it kind of looks like that. So you do have a number of Linux systems. They all run a usually reasonably recent kernel. That I've been saying that for 3 years now, so it's not that recent anymore. You typically need a 3.13 or higher kernel version, which, it's been running for a while now. On top of the Linux kernel, we are using the LXC library, which is the same base as LXC. But on top of that, the LXC library, we then have LXD, which does all of the handles all of the user interaction and exports the REST API and does all of the network part of it. Then on top of all of that, you've got the LXC REST API that lets you interact with all of those machines. And as API clients, we've got our common line tools, what I'm going to use in the demo. Or we've got a plugin to integrate into OpenStack called NovaLXD. If you install that inside your OpenStack, you're then able to mark whether an OpenStack image is meant for VMs or for containers. And depending on what your users deploy, they will just get either a VM or a container. But as far as what they're seeing, it's exactly the same thing. Like all the OpenStack APIs and features pretty much work the exact same way. So, as I briefly mentioned, LXD is not federation technology. It is entirely container-based. That means we don't have any of the overheads that comes with that. It also does mean that you cannot run something that requires a special kernel or kernel modules or like another operating system entirely inside an LXD container, obviously. But a lot of people are actually running Linux on top of Linux, and using Kafka machines for that can feel like a bit of a waste, especially considering the kind of density difference you get between containers and virtual machines. Containers, when they idle, they really don't use any kind of resources. The Linux kernel does a pretty good job at not wasting time scheduling things that are not asking to be scheduled. Whereas with virtual machines, you will always get some amount of internal, some amount of context switching between your VMs, just because of all the virtual hardware and all the way all that stuff works together. That means that you can run like in the thousands of completely idle containers that don't do anything on the system, whereas you might be able to run maybe 100 or so VMs that do the same thing. Obviously, once the workload does start pegging your CPU, you're going to end up with somewhat the same capacity, because VMs are pretty good doing purely CPU-bound tasks. But for idling and for workloads that are not nearly as active, you can get a lot more density using LXD and containers. LXD is also not a fork of LXD. It's developed by the exact same team that behind LXD. We still maintain the LXD tools. LXD is based on the LXD library. So all of our interactions directly with the kernel are actually going through libLXD. But it was, for us as a project, a really good way of coming up with a new, clean user experience without breaking anyone who's using the lower level tools that we had before. So we keep supporting both. And if you want something that's very easy to configure, to control, to understand, that does the network abstraction, or that kind of stuff, you can use LXD. If you are working on embedded systems or other systems where you are very resource constrained, then you might want to just use either the LXD directly or use the LXD tools that are tiny in comparison. And lastly, what LXD is and isn't. LXD, as I said, runs system containers. System containers means you run an entire Linux distro, typically unmodified, exactly as you would on a physical system or virtual machine. You can actually move a physical system or virtual machine inside a system container relatively easily. It's just a matter of getting root from the system across. It's pretty different from what you get with Rocket and Docker, which are usually defined as application containers. Those are typically ephemeral containers that run a single process. As soon as that process exists, you consider the container as having stopped, effectively. They don't usually run in the system. You can't usually use your existing tooling or SSH into them, all that kind of stuff. They're really meant for typically stateless-type workloads in like a microservice environment, where you just own a bunch of tiny containers that do just one thing very well and nothing else. Usually don't have data attached to them that are usually going from some separate service or separate container. Whereas with LXD, you can move any existing workload you've got, use all your configuration tools that already exist, and just do that inside a container instead of wasting either space in your rack by running a physical system or wasting precious resources by running virtual machines where you're effectively running the same kernel inside and outside of the VM. Main LXD components. So, LXD obviously manages containers. Containers can be snapshotted. We can also interact with their files, configuration, attach devices, pull log files. Quite a number of operations we can do. I just recommend I talk about the API. All of our containers are based on images. We do publish daily images for a good chunk of distros. You can also build your own images if you want to. Or you can publish an existing container as an image that you can then use to create more containers on different machines. We also have an abstraction layer, which is pretty useful, especially when dealing with resource constraints and attaching devices and that kind of stuff. Those are profiles. Profiles can have config and devices attached to them, and then profiles can be attached to containers. So you can just do your configuration once for a given type of service, and then just use that profile for your containers. somewhat recently on SourceForge, over a year now, we added support for network configuration. That means that the NX API lets you create bridges either using the Linux kernel directly or OpenV switch as its backend. Then bridge either physical devices or just keep it internally virtual with the host doing routing. You can also, it also supports basic tunneling, so we can do GRE crosshost or VXLAN crosshost, so that you can create a virtual network on, like, without needing VLANs or any kind of physical configuration of your network. And we pretty recently now, and implemented storage pools and storage volumes as well. So before that, LexD would only support a single type of storage backends. It does support directory, LVM, BurFS, and ZFS at the time. Then the storage pools feature effectively lets you create multiple of those, and then you can choose, okay, container A goes on my ZFS, SSD back storage pool, container B goes on my slow hard disk, LVM, VG that I've got over there. And you can also allocate storage volumes for that, which effectively then you can attach to a given mount point inside the container. So you can say that all your containers are on slow spindle-based storage, on BurFS, for example, and then you've got a very fast SSD-backed LVM or something that you can then carve volumes from and attach that to, say, Vali PostgreSQL or something like that inside the container to just have some specific paths inside the container coming from a different pool. LexD, because of its REST API network awareness, can also pretty easily interact between different hosts. So the images that you have on one host can be marked as public, which then effectively turns your host into an image server. So if you bind it to the network, you can then pull those images and create containers from them on separate hosts. Exact same thing works for containers. You can copy containers between hosts and move them between hosts. Even if you're lucky enough that your kernel works and you've got the right version of Cryo and a bunch of other pretty finicky dependencies, you can even do it live. So you can have a container that's running and do live migration of a container from one host to another, where it's running state, like all the process memory and CPU state and all the stack and all that stuff. It's serialized down to disk, transferred across, and then processes are recreated exactly as they were on target. That's pretty cool technology, but really depends on your workload. Some people are lucky enough that they can use that in production because their workload just works perfectly. There's nothing weird that cannot be serialized by Cryo. But it's kind of hit or miss. Still a pretty good feature when it works. So now for the slightly less boring part of this, showing you what things about. Let's move this way. There we go. That should be big enough. So first thing, I'm on a Debian stretch system. Pretty clean install. Just installed it from the USB stick 2 days ago. And I'm just going to show you how you can install LexD. Can I come back to that afterwards? But like, unfortunately, we don't have native packages on Debian right now. But what we do have is a native package for Snapd in Debian Stretch, which we can install. Then we can just install core base. Should take a few seconds. And then we can install LexD on top of that, and we'll get LexD working on it. LexD does release monthly for feature releases, so you're going to get some new features and possibly some model changes in there every month. The alternative is we do have an LTS branch of LexD, which releases every 2 years and gets support for 5 years, where we then do bug fix and security updates with a bug fix release usually every 2 or 3 months. That tends to be a better fit for distros because that's not as fast moving. LexD being written in Go, dependency might be a bit annoying sometimes. So using the LTS release means you can package all the dependencies once and then you're good because we won't add new ones. Whereas the feature release might change quite a bit from month to month, which might be difficult to catch up with for packaging. Alright. So XD is installed. The first thing you can do is we've got NextDNet. That's a interactive configuration tool. It also, if you need to set up a bunch of different machines, you can do it through YAML. So you can have like a YAML file that defines all your host settings, and you can just feed that in one shot. And then it won't ask you anything. You can also directly talk to the API or call the commands by hand. That's always funny. I think the problem, just going to disconnect and reconnect. Snap the added set to the path, and sometimes it's not properly cached. I'm guessing that's what's happening there. There we go. Okay, so that's the NextDNet running. It first asks me whether I want to create a new storage pool. By default, it's got none, so obviously you need one, otherwise you're going to have a bit of a problem storing your containers. Just call it default, and we want something very optimized, so let's use BurrelFS. When I say vaguely optimized, it means that NextD will store images as BurrelFS. Oh, actually, this is the function, question I wanted to answer. Oops. BurrelFS. Because I wanted it to be exposed to the network that way. So it's optional to have NextD itself bind on the network, otherwise, you can talk to it over Unix socket, which is what that tool is doing right now. For local users, you can usually want to use Unix socket, but since my demo will also include some cross-host work, I need to have it by network. Enterprise A, create a default bridge, yes. Okay, there we go. So I was saying for storage, NextD does do optimized storage, so if you use BurrelFS, LVM, or ZFS, or Ceph as well, I think there's always a way I can support that. When an image is first imported, it will be optimized, so it will be converted into like a ZFS dataset, or BurrelFS volume, or Ceph image, or LVMAV. And then that's being snapshotted for the very critical container to make it much, much faster to create them afterwards. Anyway, my Linux is configured, so I've got the bridge, I've got the storage pool right now, so I can launch containers. First one, I'm just going to use the stretch image from my image server, so I'm going to run that quickly. To which point now it's. So it was actually pretty quick, but it did have to unpack it and convert it to BurrelFS volume and then create a container from it. So we've got that image. We can also do the CentOS 7 image, because why not? So long as you're on a pretty recent kernel, you usually don't have any problems running on the distros. So in this case, I've got Debian Stretch and CentOS both running on Debian Stretch. Now that that's done, you can do Lexi list that shows you your containers running, their PV4, PV6 addresses, whether they're persistent or ephemeral. So you can do a dash D flag, which will make a container ephemeral. As soon as the container stops, it will just get wiped. We can get some information on the given container with Lexi info. So we can see all of these local devices inside it, what IP they got. We can see some information, number of processes running, amount of CPU time it's used so far, memory usage, what was the peak memory usage for the container, and network statistics on all devices, which can all be useful for people who want to then do monitoring from input outside the container without having to install an agent inside it. They can pull that data from the API. And to get a shell inside the container, I can just do this. The other nice thing is that that works over the network, that works over our REST API, but it does not need anything inside the container because it just injects a process inside the container, which means that I can do this. So I don't have any IP in the container, but I can still interact with it just fine, which can be pretty useful to go and recover as that's going to get responsive. Now, let's play with resource limits a bit. I'm just going to need to restart that container because I would kind of like it to open it, but I'm going to just leave that. So, there. Okay, so in that container right now, if I go and look at the number of processes, I've got quite a few on that system. And I should also have quite a bit of memory right now. Yeah, I do have 32 gigs of RAM. I'm just going to reconnect on another shell just to show you that the container itself is not going down. So I'm going to set C1, I want to limit CPU user to 2. There we go. So I can go back here. And now if I look, I only have 2 CPUs. There we go. And same thing for memory. So just do 8 gigabyte. And 8 gigabyte. Obviously, don't try to set the memory limits to lower tools than what you're using right now. You're going to have a pretty hard time. The kernel is going to trigger yet a memory killer, but you might not be super happy about it. But otherwise, it's fine. The other thing that's always kind of neat too is, I mean, if anyone ever played with TC, you probably know just how annoying it can be. But thankfully, we do that for you. So just installing wget now, which will then let me download some random big blob from a local machine. That should download pretty quickly. Yeah, we see 112 megabytes per second. But now I'm gonna set a limit of 10 megabit. And if I go back here, we see it's gonna go down, and cap to 10 megabit. Or we can have it move back up to 100 megabit. And it's gonna go back up slowly to 100 megabit. There we go. So Lexi does nicely abstract that for you. You can just limit ingress and egress of any given container. You just send the TC queue limits and all that stuff for you. It works pretty well. The other thing that's interesting here is rather than modifying the container itself, so you can see the first two commands I was doing config set directly on the container. The last two I was actually modifying the default profile, which means that all containers that were using that profile on this host now have that limit applied to them. That can be pretty useful if you need to set a different class of service or something. You can just change a profile, just apply to a container's life. All our resource limits can be changed immediately. There's no need to restart anything. Okay. The next kind of obvious feature that's always nice to show too is we support snapshotting. So you can create a quick snapshot of the container. It's going to be listed in info. So we see at the bottom there's a demo snapshot that's marked as stateless. If you've got Creo working for your workload, you can even store the running CPU and memory state of the container and restore it as well. So in this case, it's a stateless container. Now let's just go and do some damage. Let's see. Just executing. Let's just wipe out CD. Why not? At which point, Bash looks a bit sad. It's no longer a set post name. And okay, no more EC. And we can just restore this thing real quick. And go back in business. So snapshots work exactly the way you'd expect them to. Now, device pass-through is also pretty interesting. It doesn't work the same way as VMs. With VMs, if you want to pass device, it either needs to be like a virtual device that's created by your hypervisor, or it needs to be using VFIO and passing a full PCI device. That can be a bit annoying, you know, depending on your setup. So here, what I've got is one of those halfway named physical device, ENP70, I think. So we can move it into the container, say, attach a new NIC. It's a physical device that needs to be moved. It's called ENP70. We want it called, but the same thing, it's in the container. Just run this, and if we go back into the container, we'll see that we've got at the top ENP70. And it's got from host at this point. You can also pass any kind of unique character device or block device that you want to a container. So in this case, I'm just going to pass devkvm. So just add a new device of type unique character device, pass devkvm, and you've got devkvm in the container. Which would now that you run QEU and then run your own virtual machines inside an individual container. So if something goes wrong with QEU's virtual devices, then the user is still stuck inside the container. Gonna briefly show the REST API. So in this case, I'm using curl against the Unix socket. You can do this the same thing against the HTTPS socket, then you've got to pass the client certificate. We do TLS certification for API. In this case, I'm just gonna be listing the containers. So we see I've got C1 and C2. I can try and list what's going on for C1. That's gonna be pretty long, but. If we list C1, we see all its direct config, what architecture it is, what devices are attached to it, whether it's ephemeral or not, what profiles are applied. And then we see the expanded config, which is the configuration it's got after all profiles have been applied. So it's, if you usually want to see what's actually going on with the container, that's the one you want to look at. The normal config is just container local config, but doesn't include everything that's inherited. Let's see, it's running. And lastly, cool thing, okay, so we've got access to the containers file system policy, and you can just do /files /etc/host, and there you go, you just get the file content. say I wanted to delete the file, I can just do x delete, just send a delete request instead. It says success, and if I go inside the container, I'm probably not going to have post files anymore. There we go, post files gone. So that makes it pretty easy to sort of script around pushing files into your container, modifying anything. Our command line tool will let you do things like, let's say, file edit c1, it's hostname. And it spawns a text editor for you, pulling the file, letting you modify it, and pushing it back over the API as soon as you modify it. Now, just showing you how things work remotely. So I switched to my laptop now. I've got a different set of containers that are on my own laptop. I also have a list of remotes that we can see. So we've got a bunch of default remotes. Images is what I use to pull the Debian images. That's our community run image server. Local is your local XD. That's the default remote. So you just do XD, you're actually talking to local. Then I've got Saha, which is like one of my development systems. And I've got the Ubuntu cloud images sources as well. But the machine I was showing stuff, doing stuff on earlier was called Lentera, so let's add it. It does a SSH-like thing which shows you the certificate on the server. You can go and compare using an XE info on this target server if you want to. In this case, I'm pretty sure I'm not being money in the middle. Then it asks you for a trust password. That's what I set up during the LXD init state. It's only used to add your certificate to the target server. It's not used afterwards. So you can just use it as an intro and check thing. Once all your clients are added, you can set the password and nobody can control the password anymore. And now what I can do is, so if I do LXDList, I list my local containers. If I do LXDList and here colon, then it's going to list the remote containers. If I want to stop C2 on here, I can do this. There we go, I can stop it. I can just list it properly like this. And now let's say I want to move C2 from Lentera over to Saha. So my client itself has credentials on both servers. The two servers themselves don't have credentials to each other. It will create a temporary token for that given container to transfer from one to the other, and then tell the target host to go and pull the container from the source. Which is what's going on right now. We see it's transferring reasonably quickly, and done. So now if I look on Saha, I'm going to have a C2 container over there. You can also copy containers or container snapshots. So in this case, I'm copying the demo snapshot I created earlier and making a new container called blah on Saha based from it. That's a nice way of just like setting something up and then copying it into a bunch of containers to get it used for production. And then if we look at Saha, we're going to have blah showed up here. Now for something a bit different. One thing that's kind of neat these days, we've got those beefy GPUs that you can use for a lot of different computation type things. The main problem with using those virtual machines is that you either need a GPU that's very fancy and can split itself into a bunch of different GPU chunks that you can then pass to your virtual machines using VFIO. Or you need to have a whole bunch of physical GPUs to your system, which is not always ideal. But if you're using a normal Linux system, you can have multiple applications talking to your NVIDIA or AMD or whatever target devices just fine from our operating system. And that's what containers still let you do because they're still running on a single kernel. So I've got that other host called Saha. I've got a container called CUDA, which I'm going into right now. And let's run a bandwidth test. And that blows up because, well, there's no GPU in there. It's pretty happy, it doesn't have any GPU. Let's give it a GPU. So that host has two identical NVIDIA GPUs. I just passed the first one, so I told it ID equals 0. If you don't specify an ID, it's going to give you all the GPUs, which might be fine because I just want to pass a specific one. So if I do NVIDIA SMI again, we say that we've got a GeForce 730 attached to it now. And if we run the bandwidth test, it's going to actually do CUDA stuff on the GPU. Now, if you want to pass the second one, you can just pass either one as well. Go back inside the container. And we see we've got two GeForce 730s now. That makes like resource allocation pretty easy. LXD will figure out the device nodes that need to be passed, so it will set up your dev NVIDIA 0, 1, whatever. or if you're using OpenCL with AMD, it's going to set up your DevDRI nodes, just figuring out what GPU you want and then figuring out what device nodes are tied to that and then passing those into the container. It also lets you do like per PCI bus address or vendor ID or product ID, so it can be pretty specific as to what GPU you actually want to allocate it to one container. Now, something slightly different that probably more people can play with rather than out of the box is I've got a container locally on my laptop called If I run any DB devices in there, I don't see any devices. Say, if I attach an Android phone to it now, Android phone attached, it's still not going to show me anything. That's because it doesn't, if we do config show on that Android dev, we see it doesn't have any devices listed, just an empty list. But now I can pass saying that vendor ID is my it's actually coming from an SUSB, so I picked my Sony Ericsson entry here. I've got the vendor ID, product ID for it. I just add it. I go inside the container. And now I've got the USB device attached to it. And I can get into the shell of my phone. This is somewhat limited to only libUSB compatible software, because what we pass are the /dev/bus/USB device nodes. If something depends on a specific kernel driver that does not use that, then the kernel driver will usually create Unix character device or Unix block devices nodes for you, at which point you can use our Unix character device or Unix block device pass through and use that instead. But for anything that uses libUSB, something that's purely a user space USB handling type thing, that works very well too. So briefly, what do we support as far as images for XD? We have daily images for a whole bunch of distros. We've got Alpine Linux, Arch Linux, CentOS, and Debian, Fedora, Gentoo, OpenSUSE, Oregon, Plamo, which is like a Japanese, I think it's a Slackware-based distro, Satayan, and Ubuntu. For most of them, we try to support to have like daily builds of all the different images. Architecture support is usually restricted to MD64 or 386. Unless we get special requests, then we can try to get some dedicated build time for that on other architectures. We do have builders for PBC64, ELS, 390X, on ARM64, but we don't have nearly as much capacity for those as we do on x86. So it's kind of best effort. Ubuntu does exist for all architectures. I believe Debian does too. I think we've enabled the 390X, PBC64N, and ARM64 for it. Fedora and CentOS, I think, wanted to get ARM64 added at one point, but they don't build it, so there's that. Now, as far as where XD itself is available, we are available in quite a few distros, so Alpine, Arch Linux, Debian, Fedora, Gentoo, OpenSUSE, and Ubuntu. How to get it does vary a bit depending on distros. So for Alpine, we've got a native package. For Arch Linux, you can either use in the UR repo, which also has to come for us, has to include a special kernel that supports user namespaces, or you can use the snap package that I used on Debian here. It's the exact same way on Arch Linux. Yeah, in both cases, you do need the custom kernel because otherwise you're stuck to just privileged containers. So containers that do not use the user namespace. For Debian right now, it's just a snap. We do have a ITP that's been open for a while now. As far as I know, all the Debian core dependencies required for XD are in package and are in the archive now. They just missed stretch. And the next step is for someone to actually push XD itself. I would strongly recommend that the XD LTS branch is gets into Debian rather than the monthly release thing, just because we don't do long-term support on the monthly releases, and you might be a bit unhappy having to do a lot of cherry-picking there. For Fedora, we've got a couple repository, which I believe can also be made to work on CentOS. It's not ideal right now. Native packages on Gentoo, OpenSUSE, and Ubuntu have Snap. Ubuntu also has a native package. All of those we do on all of the snap ones we've got automated CI. So whenever we change anything, we get tests on all those issues. We test all the storage backends as well. And we've even added Ceph support right now. It's added in the latest Lexi release, and it's going to come to the snap of the next Lexi release due to a bit of a trick that was needed there. But with that, you can use, if you've got an existing Ceph cluster that you at your workplace or wherever, you can then use that as storage for container images and containers themselves, as well as attach path coming from the Ceph RBD volume into your container. Just show you what the so what does the image list look like? So you've got Lexi image list. You can just plug that. Lexi image list will list you your local images. So in my case, it's Lexi does automatic caching for you. So the first time you create a container from a given image, if you don't have it locally, it gets downloaded for you. Then the container is created from it, and Lexi will then keep that image up to date in the background. Checking every 6 hours if there's a new version, then it updates from that up to an expiry. So we've got a default expiry of 10 days. That means that if a given image has not been used for any container over the past 10 days, then the image is automatically removed from the local image store, just to avoid clutter in there. All of that is configurable, so you can turn off the expiry, or you can have it very aggressively expire, or you can turn off auto image download. You can, all of that is configurable. And we've got that remote image server called images that I mentioned earlier. So if we access that, we can see all of the distro images. We've got a whole bunch of Alpine, a whole bunch of Debian, then other distros like Oracle Linux, and a bunch of Ubuntu images. And the image server also lets you download images up to 3 days old. So if you need to do some comparison as to why something is definitely broke, you can get some slightly older images if you need to. So, Lexi itself has solved the project. Lexi is written in Go. We interact with the Lexi library through a Go Lexi binding. So we're a bit unusual in that a lot of Go projects don't like depending on the kind of C code. That's not the case for Lexi. We do pretty happily use C libraries as needed. Like all of our interactions with containers is done effectively through a C library. Lexi itself is fully translatable. Like all the command line tools and commands I've used can be translated. It's all on WebLate, so you can go online and translate Lexi and that gets into the next release. We've got API client libraries between Go and Python that we maintain ourselves. There are also people who've made some for Java, Ruby, and a bunch of other languages that might be at feature priority of upstream or not. They tend to lag behind a tiny bit. Lexi itself is Apache 2 licensed. We don't have any kind of CLI to contribute to Lexi. The only thing that we require is the developer certificate of ownership. So just a simple sign up by new commits and can contribute to Lexi. Quick recap before we go to questions. So Lexi, it runs system containers that are created from images. That's what I showed earlier. Pretty much everything is image based, so you know exactly. Kind of the exact same image multiple hosts, create containers there, you know, they're gonna work the exact same way. That's different from what we used to do with Lexi, where you were running effectively like a template script that was creating your local image from the bootstrap or similar tools for other distros, and then converting that into a tarball and using that to create your containers. So you weren't completely sure you would get the exact same thing everywhere. Now you are the Lexi image fingerprint that you can see. So if I do ximage info, say I want to be on stretch. There we go. The first line is the SHA-256 of the image. That's if the image is a single file, it's just a SHA-256 of that file. If it's made of multiple files, just concatenated version. But all files concatenated together and hashed. So you can make sure that you've got the exact same bits everywhere because the image identifier is its fingerprint. Lexi containers are safe by default. We use it, unlike what we did with Lexi at the beginning, where none of those toolings were around. Lexi does use all the namespaces that are available by default. We use cgroup for resource constraints, we use seccomp for syscode filtering, where it makes sense, and we use apama if available as an extra safety net as well. So if you use the default legacy container, the only kind of attacks you can really do is running the system out of resources, because we don't do any kind of resource limits by default, but you can configure those if you want to. You can even configure an extra security feature which makes every single container not only be unprivileged, but be unprivileged with its own range of UIDs and GIDs. That means that kernel bits that would otherwise cross namespace boundaries, say view limits, will no longer be able to cross because the UID is only used in a single container. It's obviously a bit wasteful because you usually want 65,536 UIDs and GIDs per container just to be POSIX compatible. But and you can still run 65,000 containers even if you use that. So thankfully we've got quite a number of UIDs and GIDs we can make use of. The resource limitation is very similar to what you can do with virtual machines. That's what I showed earlier. You can limit CPU, time, memory, network I/O, block I/O, disk space. It does depend what kind of backend you support, what kind of cgroups are enabled obviously on your system, but you can be pretty fine-grained as far as what you limit. To the point where we actually run an online service where you can get a root access to a LXD container with container nesting enabled to it for 30 minutes to play with. And we've not had anyone be able to really deOS the system or otherwise escape the container. I mean, it's also against the terms of service, but we know that nobody reads those. So, so far, some people did try running things like fork bombs in there, but we do have a process limit that can be applied, which effectively prevents that. I mean, you're going to very successfully deOS yourself, but you're not going to be able to take the host down with you. We also have device parser, as I mentioned. We support parsing Unix character block devices. We support parsing network interfaces, as I showed earlier, GPU, USB devices, as well as disks. For disks, it's either passing a given path, in which case it's effectively a bind mount, like zero overhead file system access, or you can mount a specific block device into a given path of the container as well. LXD will do the mount for you. LXD is very, very low overhead. We're not seeing zero overhead because it turns out that the C groups, when enabled, do have some amount of overhead that might affect your container. If you don't apply any kind of resource limits, it will usually be zero overhead. It's just effectively the same as running something natural root. So extremely fast. You don't have any of the kind of IO related overhead and stuff that the virtual machines would get you. And LXD has like extremely low level access to any device that you want. As I mentioned, you can pass Unix kernel devices, Unix block devices, anything that's supported by your host Linux kernel can be passed into the container and be used from there. That's pretty different from having to first find a VFIU compatible motherboard, CPU, and cards, and then pass physical PCI devices with virtual machines, which can be pretty painful to set up. The obvious caveat is that if you're running something that requires, say, a DKMS type kernel module, then you have to install it on the host and then pass the resulting devices into the container. The container itself cannot, I mean, it can build the kernel module, it won't be able to load it. LXD is entirely based on a REST API. All the command line tools I showed earlier were all talking to LXD over the REST API, either over its local Unix socket or when dealing with remote servers over HTTPS, sending the exact same thing. So that means that, say, when you want to execute a command inside the container, that's using a normal REST API call to negotiate that connection, which then gets you a number of WebSockets, and those WebSockets are then connected directly to your PTS devices, passing your command through, and everything works pretty much exactly like if it was a normal shell. You can run something that uses curses or other fancy terminal libraries, and everything will work just fine, like all the escape sequences and stuff are passed through. We also catch signals and send those through as well. So if you send a signal to your local process, it will forward that signal to the target host over the API, so long as the signal is something we can block, obviously. And lastly, LXD is very much production ready. As I mentioned, we do have that LTS branch. We do have production users, quite a lot of them actually, using it. We do have also people who prefer having the new latest features and just feature branch. It tends to be about 50-50 as far as we can tell. for users within one or the other. Both of them are very much supported. We are very, very reactive at dealing with bug reports of any kind directly on GitHub, or we have a pretty active support community as well. We've got a forum and mailing list that people can ask questions in. And that's it for what I've got. We've got 5 minutes for questions, if there is any. Yes.
Yes, I'm wondering whether you have an image repository and collections of standard images to deploy.
So the image repository we run are clean distribution images right now. So that's what I showed. We've got all those distros. We build daily images for them on multiple architectures. We don't have a app store type thing where you've got, you know, pre-packaged services and stuff. It's something that someone could run. I think there was some interest from some people already doing that, but for LXC to then support it as the LXC image server as well and then start using that. We don't really have an interest like upstream on our side to start packaging all the web applications or that kind of stuff, because that's just time consuming and that people would know a little bit better than we do.
Yeah, thanks a lot. I'm very much looking forward for LXD to be available in Debian. So why did you choose, it's a design question, why did you choose to create a separate daemon and why not, let's say, contribute to libvirt?
So libvirt did have a libvirt LXC driver, which had nothing to do with LXC for a long time, so we've always had a bit of friction upstream with that to some extent. Also, we didn't feel that libvirt was really a library or a daemon with an API that people could really interact with. All of the network layer of libvirt is a bit special, and that is mostly SSH-based calling version and running set commands over that, which is not ideal. But the main reason really was that we wanted to be container focused. Libvirt does support containers with LXC, but its focus was really virtual machines. And so the libvirt integration for things like pulling and pushing files into a container doesn't really make sense in the API, since they're really focused around virtual machines. It just didn't feel like a super good fit, plus the existing confusion around the libvirt LXC driver was a bit of a problem too. It felt like we could do something much cleaner with a very clean REST API, much faster and much more easily, honestly.
So I have two questions.
Yes.
The first one, can the process running inside the container be put to swap? What is the relation to that, how does it work? And the second question is, are Debian people involved in creating the LXC image that you can download?
Okay, so for the first question for the swap, yes, we do have, as part of our memory limits, you can control a swap priority, and you don't have very fine-grained control because we don't have per container swap files, unfortunately. But what you can do is set that what containers should be swapped first, and you can turn off swapping for given containers. So containers that you never want to swap, you can turn off swap in them, which would effectively set the swapping end so that none of those processes would ever be swapped unless the entire system is swapping. And for containers you care less, you can set the priority so that they get swapped first. Now, for the Debian image, the way our images are built right now is we've got the Jenkins server that runs the LXC Debian template. So it's the same shared script I mentioned earlier, so just that we run those centrally. So you can find those in the LXC code tree. You've got, it's effectively a shared script that's being run that spits out a root file system that gets then packed into both a .exe and a squash.fs image that's then distributed. You can use all the Jenkins scripts and tooling also on GitHub, so you can run our build image script and then it's just going to spit out artifacts that you can use on container images if you want.
I'm just looking for a clarification about the LXC config parameters, because it's a very convenient way of altering your container while it's running. Is this a persistent config change or is it just a ephemeral kind of a
All those config changes are persistent. So the way they work is that it modifies the database state immediately and then applies it as well. We have in our documentation the list of all config actions and whether they can be applied live or not. The vast majority of them can. The usual exceptions are if you try to modify something like the seccomp policy, or if you want to make a container that's currently unprivileged be privileged, that needs like a file system remapping, which you can only do over a restart. So it will let you set the key, but it's only effective after restart.
This is perhaps just an OC question, but is there any savings across containers resource-wise for file system caching and library caching, and how does that work if you have a lot of identical containers?
Yeah, so the kernel does some of that for you, but the usual answer is that it doesn't really. If your underlying file system somehow manages to have the same inode for a given library for both containers, then the kernel will do the caching perfectly for you because it knows that the library is already loaded and magic. We've been looking at doing a KSM type thing. It is possible to load, there's like a KSM library that can be loaded into like as an LD preload for all your processes, in which case it will mark all process memory as doing the DM advice call to make it make the kernel DDEB work on it. The tests that we've seen from community members so far have not been impressive. It looks like a whole bunch of CPU usage for about less than 20% gain. It depends on workloads. I think we've got some web hosting people that do run with the LD preload installed, and they do get some amount of saving, but it's not usually magical. What we do get as far as saving is obviously the disk space, because that part is we create an optimized image and we clone from it. So if you use LVMware FS, EFS, or Ceph, those will get you very cheap copies and instant copies for the underlying file system. But for memory, it's right now the answer is it usually doesn't. The answer is that it usually doesn't matter so much for the workload we've seen. And for the workload where it really does matter, you can install that libkSM, I think it's called, which effectively lets you do that at a per container basis. The reason why we can't really do it centrally in NXT is simply because since containers are effectively a set of processes running inside a namespace, NXT does not own their memory. So NXT itself cannot mark that memory as being ready for DDEB in the kernel. Cool. Any other question? I don't think I'm running out of time. So. So thank you very much. We do have a bunch of stickers here. There are a bunch of stickers on the front desk table too, if anyone wants those. Otherwise, you can go on our website, where you can try NXT online. It's like a fancy JavaScript type thing where you get root access to a random NXT server that then lets you run through something somewhat similar to my demo, but not quite in as much in depth, to play with it. And then if you want to use it, we've got the Getting Started guide that tells you how to install the snap, and if you're using Debian or other packages, depending on what distro you're running. Thank you.